It is now my pleasure to introduce Professor Peter Edwards. I got to know Peter Edwards as a very independent thinker. Not too long ago, we were both at the round table discussion on the future of economy, and then he attacked or challenged, I would say, the what is now almost become a dogma that the trend for cities to grow and for the world population to get together in cities is an absolute. Peter Edwards challenged and said that it's not necessarily so. He argued that it was because there's always unexpected developments taking place, and the consequences of an faster moving evolution and introduction of new information technology might lead to such unexpected consequences that we need to think about those. So unexpected consequences are a typical characteristic or are typical for interventions in complex systems. And society is such a complex system, and the introduction of new technology into it is such an intervention. And every day we can see their unintended consequences. Now, Peter Edwards has thought a lot about this question and also why governments give so little attention to the consequences of introducing such new technologies. So he's going to talk about this. So please welcome Peter Edwards.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Technological myopia. But let me begin with a quotation, which I'm sure many of you recognize. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. We had everything before us, we had nothing before us. I think that's an almost spine-chilling sentence which opens the Tale of Two Cities by Dickens. In fact, the sentence goes on considerably longer than that, but you can't fit it onto a screen. And I think it captures rather well our ambivalence towards technology. On the one hand, we believe in technology. There's a kind of glittering utopia in front of us as we make more and more use of technologies. And this is my everyday work. I work in a program called the Future Cities Laboratory, which is trying to make cities more sustainable and more resilient. And of course, we use all kinds of smart technologies. And we see people from government and we see people from business coming in, and they are completely captured by this belief that as we use technologies more effectively, we can make our cities smart, we can make them energy efficient, we can recycle materials, we can increase equality, we can care for the elderly, make them sustainable, make them resilient. And this is the Tianjin Eco-City, which is a Sino-Singaporean initiative, and it is one of these great experiments in whether one really can use modern technologies to achieve all of these things. But it's a reflection in our belief in technology. And associated with that belief in technology is an almost frantic push for innovation. If you live in Singapore, as I do now, innovation is a word you hear every day. Singaporean government is going to enormous lengths to establish an innovation community. So we have incubators and accelerators and startup programs and mentoring schemes, and I don't know what, because innovation is good, and disruptive innovation is even better. So that's one aspect of it. That is the best of times, the age of light. But funnily enough, society at this very moment is also deeply pessimistic about technologies. And there are many, many influential people writing to argue that sooner or later, technology will be our doom. Just one or two which I've come to my attention. Not so long ago, Stephen Hawking said that strong artificial intelligence could, maybe even would, in due course, bring an end to humanity. There was a report a couple of years ago through NASA, which took a very gloomy view of our future and what technology would do. The fruits of technology are growing economic inequality, rapid population growth, and resource depletion, and many others. So I'm sure you've all seen them, that climate change, which is indirectly a consequence of our technology, biotechnology, nanotechnology, or something else, will spell the end of civilization. And just a book which I've just ordered, I haven't read yet, but I've read the review, clearly reflects this dystopian view of our future. Yuval Noah Harari, Homo Deus, A Brief History of Tomorrow, paints the bleakest picture of how our technological future will look, with a sort of fragmentation of society, creation of a kind of technological superstate, is what I understand. So I find that paradoxical. And what I'm going to tell you today is really simply my reflections upon this ambivalence towards technology, and try and ask, why is society so divided about it? Try and ask, and one of the answers, I think, is that it depends whether you see the immediate consequences of technology or you think in a much more complex systems fashion and you can see some of the other consequences. And I want to show that every major new technology that we introduce is a new adventure. It's going to take us somewhere quite unexpected. And if that's the case, I'm going to say, shouldn't we perhaps be just a little bit more interested in where it will take us? If each new technology is riding a tiger, perhaps we'd like to know where that tiger is going to take us. And I'm going to start by taking some examples of major technologies that have happened, been introduced during my lifetime, which have had enormous consequences, some of them foreseen, some of them very beneficial, some of them unforeseen, and arguably less beneficial. So let's start. And I'm going to start with the Green Revolution. And I can also start by saying that the way I got into this, the way I started thinking about the Green Revolution, was because of my current position. I work in a research center, as I've said. We have a program, the Future Cities Laboratory. And for the first time in my career, I started to think about cities and the dynamics of cities and how they happen. I should perhaps explain I'm an ecologist. I'm a plant ecologist. I did my PhD on nutrient cycling in tropical rainforest. And I had never thought about cities until about 3.5 years ago. And I came to Asia, and one of the things you discover in Asia is this almost unbelievable rate of urbanization, which is occurring now. There's a city just an hour's ferry ride away from here, which is growing at a rate of 7.5% per year. And there are many other cities in Asia growing at a similar rate. So urbanization is happening on an unprecedented scale now here. So I asked my colleagues, who knew much more about cities than I did, well, why is it? What is it? What has happened in this state of human history that suddenly, over a period of a very few decades, there should be this tremendous urbanization, so that new megacities are appearing, many of them you've never even heard of, but nonetheless, they're megacities growing very fast. And they gave me various references to look at, and I must say I found the literature on urbanization extremely unsatisfactory. You find diffuse statements about why people move into cities. There are push factors and there are pull factors, and the pull factors are that you want to have the quality of the urban life, you want to enjoy the benefits of modern infrastructure, you want to have a regular job in industry, and the push factors are poverty away from agriculture, but all very sort of wishy-washy and descriptive. And the more I read, the more I became convinced that that one of the really powerful triggering factors for the urbanization that we're seeing now, particularly in Asia, was the Green Revolution. So let me say just a little bit about that. Starting in the 1960s, a number of new varieties of crops, particularly rice and wheat, were introduced. And in the picture, you see one of the very famous rice varieties which kicked it all off, IR8. And IR8 was enormously more productive than existing rice varieties, providing that it was well fertilized. It needed large amounts of nitrogen. So that combination gave you the chance of increasing, not by a small amount, increasing dramatically the rice yields in fields. And so the Green Revolution was not perhaps a revolution which happened overnight. It was a process by which these new rice varieties, including rice varieties specially bred to be locally adapted, coupled with the use of fertilizer and coupled with increased mechanization, were planted across the world, and particularly in the case of rice in Southeast Asia. And you can see in this figure that the effects upon rice yields were truly dramatic. They rose in different countries at different rates by a factor of something like 3 to 5-fold. And the consequences for people were also dramatic. In the early 1960s, India was in a state of really extreme food shortages. There was very serious starvation. And in a very short space of time, the Green Revolution succeeded in overcoming that problem, going from serious food shortages to a period at least of food surpluses. And in 1970, Norman Borlaug, one of the sort of pioneers of this Green Revolution, was recognized for his achievements through the Nobel Peace Prize. Now, to understand why this had such important consequences, you need to know just a little bit about the population of Southeast Asia, or Asia, and a little bit about growing rice. Rice is a very productive crop. It can feed a lot of people, but traditionally, rice also needed a lot of people in order to produce it. The sheer mechanics of making these paddy fields, the difficulty of getting machinery into paddy fields, needing to plant it all by hand and so on, meant that you needed a lot of people to produce rice, but it was also a highly productive crop. So it's not surprising then that if you look at the great rice-growing world regions of the world, they are also regions of fantastically high rural populations. Some of the highest rural populations in the world occur in these rice-growing regions. So what happened when this Green Revolution was introduced? You've got a 5-fold increase in yields. You've got mechanization, which means that fewer people are needed. So the yields that could be produced by one person probably increased by a factor of 10 in many rice-growing regions. And obviously, that had an effect upon the price. Extraordinarily, the price of grains dropped by about 40% from 1965 to 2000. And obviously, these extremely highly dense rural populations were affected by that. And so it, from an economist's point of view, it released labor from the arduous work of growing rice so that they could be used within the economy more effectively. In practice, what it meant was that the rural communities were no longer able to produce a livelihood for a large part of the population, and over a period of a number of decades, there was migration into cities, there was urbanization. So this urbanization, as people moved into the cities, associated with different forms of livelihood, mainly larger incomes, through industrialization, of course, led to growth, and the growth led to investment, and a lot of that investment went into rural areas where you had higher yields. And this, of course, is what the economists would call a virtuous cycle. And the consequence of this migration into cities, the rate at which has happened, is truly astonishing in Southeast Asia. For those of you who are just visiting, it's just one of the things to know about this region. First of all, most people live in this region. We can draw a circle with a radius of 6,000 kilometers, I think it is, around Singapore, and you've got half the world's population. And those people have been migrating into cities over the last few decades at an extraordinary rate. Here's just one study. It was what Schneider et al. Called the new urban landscape, and they merely looked at the growth of cities between 2000 and 2010. And these shapes. These rectangles are big. I think it's something like 30 kilometers by 25 kilometers. And they show that Shanghai, the Pearl River Delta, Beijing, Jakarta, many other cities have really grown at an extraordinary rate. An area the size of Taiwan has become urbanized over this 10-year period. And one thing to say about most of these people is that they were very poor, almost destitute people, not all of them and not in every country, but very poor, almost destitute people coming in from rural areas. And so this urbanization happened. Now, one of the things about our way of thinking about cities is that we think of them as units, as objects in their own right. And so the United Nations distinguishes between the rural population and the urban population. There are all kinds of institutions which are interested in the future of cities and so on. What we tend to forget is that, of course, it's the population. And some of those people are living in rural areas, and some of those are living in urban areas, but it's one system. And this migration of people into the urban areas has had an extraordinary effect upon rural areas around Asia. It's not an exaggeration to say that it is a disemboweling of rural communities. In many places, because the younger people have tended to go off and seek their fortunes in the city, you have a rapidly aging rural workforce. I know a few years ago, the average age of a farmer in Japan was 65, and I dare say it's even older now. The rural communities in many places have lost their social cohesion, their institutions. In the first generation or so, people continue to own their land, and they continue to send money back from the city simply to keep the operation in the rural areas going. What Jonathan Rigg has called the remittance landscapes, which are supported by income from the city. Obviously, these extraordinarily elaborate infrastructure of paddy fields no longer have the resources for their maintenance. One way to overcome the lack of good husbandry is to use more chemicals. So very often you have an excessive fertilizer use. But there's abandonment, there's reduced land use intensity. The environmental services which were provided by this rice-growing landscape are being lost. And very often there is agricultural expansion elsewhere of a more industrial kind. So those are all impacts for the rural areas. And of course, there are also impacts for the urban areas. One is just the land used for urbanization, which during that period of 10 years increased by 22% in the study region. There's the loss of the ecosystem services, which was associated with this highly engineered landscape. And that's leading in many cities to flooding, problems of subsidence. There are open nutrient cycles. All of these people who moved from the rural areas to the cities, of course, still need to feed. And whereas many regions had long established nutrient cycles, now we have an open nutrient cycle with the food and all of the nutrients it contains transported to the city. Beijing, for example, I think it's 50,000 tons of phosphorus get transferred to Beijing in food every year. And less than 10% of that ever finds its way back to the fields. Quite where it goes, I think nobody knows exactly, but a lot of it probably goes into the river and then into the sea. Then there are all sorts of other issues of transport losses and storage losses. Dietary changes, of course, the urban workforce with higher food, with higher incomes, different food consumptions shifts very much from the rural food, rural diet to the urban diet. Interestingly, that also means that more land is needed for agriculture. The urban population in China, for example, requires per capita over 10% more land for food production than the rural population. And then all the well-known diseases of the city life, including diabetes on the one hand, and malnutrition, and starvation on the other, due to poverty. Because, as I said, most of the people moving into very rapidly growing cities in Asia are very poor. So if you look at it that way, then this virtuous cycle of the economists is maybe not quite as virtuous as one had originally thought. The urbanization is associated with pollution, all of this phosphorus, for example, going into the rivers, but the higher yields being associated with a large increase in the use of chemicals, the loss of ecosystem services from this engineered landscape, more land being needed for agriculture, for various reasons. One I've mentioned, the change in diet. Another interesting one, around the cities, the opportunity costs of doing agriculture are rather high. You can make more money in the city than you can in a peri-urban area doing agriculture. And so land which was used for two or three rice crops a year tends to be used for just one. The intensity of use of land is less. And in China, there is now an opening up of new agricultural land in areas remote from the cities to meet the loss in production due to this effect of the opportunity costs. And it's a big effect. It's at least 10%. And issues of wealth equality and so on. So you may feel by now I have pushed the causal chain from the Green Revolution perhaps just about as far as one possibly can, because, of course, many other things have happened in the meantime. But one thing I'm convinced of is that this phase shift in agricultural productivity that occurred has had really profound consequences, which are inadequately understood upon settlement patterns and many other things, especially in Asia. Let me take my second example. I won't go into so much more detail, such detail, but it's clearly, again, one of the revolutions, the technological revolutions that has occurred, as I say, during my lifetime. 1957, the first oral contraceptive was approved. Interestingly, it was approved at that time as a treatment for menstrual disorders and infertility, and it was not till 1960 that the pill was improved for its contraceptive use in the United States. And in the United States, it was an instant hit. It was quite extraordinary how quickly the take-up happened, so that by 1967, there were 6.5 million women using it. And today, it's used by well over 100 million women throughout the world. And as we all know, it was the basis for a social revolution. Some people say it's the biggest revolution that happened during the 20th century, affecting all aspects of the structure of society. Perhaps the most central thing that's always argued is that it enabled women to plan their future. They could seriously think about an education and a career, whereas in the past they would tend to not to have done so. So it was a catalyst, I think, for this social revolution. And it led to greatly increasing professional training and careers for women. It led to all sorts of other associated social changes. Cohabitation went up, marriage went down. I'm talking mainly about Europe and the United States, or North America now. Rates of divorce went up dramatically, initially at least, in the first few decades or so. This fact that marriage or stable partnerships was being delayed also meant that there was an enormous increase in the proportion of single housing, so that whereas people living by themselves was the rarity, it becomes a very significant part of the population, particularly in cities such as New York. It led, because of this planning of the career, it led inevitably to a delay in childbearing. And in some cases, it led to permanent involuntary childlessness, which increased by a very significant proportion. So it was a major revolution. And one of the things that it clearly affected was fertility rates, which in the countries which had taken up this the oral contraception declined very rapidly indeed. And so that we now have, as a result, the aging and even declining populations. Now, I'm aware immediately that I have to put in all kinds of caveats and footnotes to a statement like that. And it's remarkably contentious in the literature just what was the effect of the oral contraceptive pill upon fertility rates. Obviously, in different countries, it's different. If you're looking in China, we are primarily looking at a one-child policy. In other countries, other reasons apply. But the consensus is that overall, in countries which adopted this technology, there was a phase change in reproductive rates, a one and for all change because a new technology had been introduced. And you can see the effect. You can see the effect in, here's just a couple of examples, in Singapore and in Germany. These are supposed to be pyramids. You know, in any kind of natural population structure, you always have more very young people than older ones because there's mortality, and so the shape of the exact shape of the pyramid will change, but the base is always wider than in the middle. And that's not true when you look at human populations in many parts of the world. There are parts of the world in Africa where it's still a very good shaped pyramid, but here we see for Singapore and for Germany this very clear effect of an efficient method of contraception introduced about 50 or 60 years ago. And in a paper which was analyzing this, the interesting thing about it, when you go to the literature, is just how undecided people studying this question were about what was the driver of this declining fertility. And many economists looked at it and decided that this was simply an economic effect. This man, Michael Murphy, examined all of these models and said that essentially the decisive factor was that there had been the introduction of an efficient contraception, and that all of the other things were still relevant factors, but they were relevant factors in the context of there existing an efficient contraception. So he argued that the change in fertility is essentially irreversible. The genie of the efficient contraception has been let out of the bottle and cannot be reinserted. And I think that's an interesting statement, not just in the context of oral contraception, but of other major technological revolutions. You can't uninvent it. Once it's been introduced out there, the system changes. And so more and more in the literature on fertility, the analyses are done before the pill existed and after the pill existed. And the pill is not a factor. It is simply, you can either look at one phase in history or you can look at another phase. Let me take the third example, and this is, of course, an extremely complex example. It's not just one invention. It's a whole series of new innovations, and it's rolling out before us now. So we don't know. We have no very accurate idea what the consequences will be. But it is the internet. And it all began in the 1960s and 70s. Packet switching networks were developed in various US and UK laboratories, a lot of them sponsored by the Department of Defense or the Ministry of Defense. 1982, the Internet Protocol Suite, the famous TCP/IP, was introduced as a standard networking protocol in an early version of the internet. 1989, World Wide Web was invented by Tim Berners-Lee working at CERN, and it provided this mechanism for the transfer of files. And in 1991, the World Wide Web was made available to the public. And you know the story after that. It has been one of these extraordinary rates of uptake of a new technology, so that by this year, the number of users has reached 3.6 billion. And of course, it's not a single technology. It is a whole suite of technologies based upon the basic concept of connected networks. And so here's a slide from Cisco, which illustrates this point and illustrates the evolution of the internet. Starts off with relatively simple things, the email, the web browser, and the search. And you can say that phase has happened, and it had enormous impact as it was introduced. And then more sophisticated consequences of networking. So e-commerce became introduced, digital supply chains, already having major consequences for the structure of commerce, with certain traditional types of businesses simply disappearing. And then becoming even more immersive with larger exchanges of data, so that it became the principal opportunity for social interactions. for entertainment, for video, and so on, the immersive experience. And then the phase which we're right in now and is happening at an almost extraordinary rate, which is connecting not just people, but connecting using internet technologies, all kinds of pieces of hardware, sensors and databases and machines and so on, in what is called the Internet of Things, and which Cisco appears to call the Internet of Everything. And we've come upon a kind of a brave new world, which is structured now by what I call the ineluctable logic of the internet. And this logic is based upon the fact that information is now distributed, that everyone has, in principle, access to that information, and that for many purposes, decisions can be made locally. You can control many aspects of one's life decentralized. And that's such a change. If you think how societies and civilizations developed, knowledge was power. If you think of the Great Library of Alexandria somewhere, or the enormous amount invested by central authorities in accumulating knowledge, because knowledge was the basis for decisions, and you had centralized information systems representing huge investment and centralized decision-making systems, which were the basis of power. And it's almost extraordinary that that system, which has existed as long as human civilization has existed, should be overturned in such a short space of time. And it has had many, many impacts, and those impacts are still unfolding. And I'll just take one or two examples, and I guess you all know these impacts, and probably many of you know them much better than I do. But it's having growing impacts upon business and employment. One, I think, very interesting example is it's restructuring large businesses. In the past, a large business, say a large manufacturing center, would clearly have the factories for its manufacturing. It would have to have the warehousing facilities. It would have to have the customer department. It would have to have the transport department, the packaging department, and so on. And so to be successful, you had to have a very complex, diverse enterprise with a large permanent staff. But with the internet and the fact that the information and the control of particular aspects of that business can be devolved, you now have the opportunity of saying, well, these are just overheads. Having to support a transport department or a packaging department is just an overhead. And if the business is not going too well, then I'm employing a lot of people and I don't need them all the time. So more and more, businesses are shedding all kinds of functions, the cleaning, the packaging, the warehousing, and so on, to other companies which are specializing in that, enormously reducing their overheads, producing what is now called a friction-free business, shedding direct employment and selecting from multiple providers and activities and services that you can sort of screw down to the last dollar. And this is very nicely described in a book recently out called David Weil, The Fissured Workplace. So that's a revolution which is happening now. Then, of course, there's another type of business opportunity, and it is this access to information and this access to clients and so on, new business models which are essentially totally bypassing the traditional corporate models. So Airbnb, I think, is one of the famous ones, producing sort of accommodation. It can turn every individual with a house or a spare room or something into a little business. And it means that our friend here in his paddy field, completely connected, can also be a businessman. And so all of these are profound changes which are just happening now. And it's certain going to continue, but we don't know exactly how far. And then other developments, again, which are changing the relationship of the citizen to the state. Money, the currency, was the one thing which was essentially guaranteed by a state. It was the complete control of the currency system. And now, of course, there are alternative virtual currencies coming into being, the most famous of them being Bitcoin, which are changing all of that. So there are profound impacts for business and employment. Some of them we think are very good, we feel very positive about. Some of them perhaps are causes for concern. More and more, the workforce is becoming a liquid workforce. Those, you know, those of us my age who sort of go into a job, have an employer, we have a nice pension, we're sort of guaranteed a job until we sort of leave. That world has completely disappeared. Fewer and fewer people are actually being employed by an employer, and they are freelance. The work is done less and less in places of work, such as the office or the factory, but more and more at home with colleagues around the world in processes of co-working and co-creation. And the very worrying thing is the consequences for job security and the traditional rights of labor protection, such as a pension, which are now in a state of very considerable flux. So it is a very rapid change associated quite clearly with the introduction of a technology. Let's take another example, and this is infrastructure. And think about the infrastructure that we have. The infrastructure before the Internet of Things came along was becoming more and more massive and centralized. The picture here on the top right-hand corner is the proposed Hinkley Point power station in the United Kingdom, which is going to be constructed with very strong support from China and France, financial support, and it's going to cost $47 billion. And it's an example of, if you like, the kind of infrastructure which developed in a world before the Internet of Things, where the economics of it were made sense for the system to be as massive as possible. It was massive and centralized, extremely expensive, very long planning times, very long lifetimes, and that presents a huge financial problem, because the economics of that means that come what may in the future, there has to be a guaranteed income stream to ensure that this massive facility doesn't represent a loss. And one of the things you therefore need to do is you over-design it. You simply build it more massively than you would really need to, because it must not fail. It's got to work productively for 50 or 60 years in order to ensure that this huge investment is paid off, amortized. It's also, of course, very obviously, a massive facility like that is low resilience. It may be very robust, but if something does happen, and of course Fukushima has shown that things can happen, then it's very vulnerable to catastrophic failure. Other interesting consequences of this before the Internet of Things philosophy. Remember the business model. This hugely expensive facility has to pay off over a long period of time. And therefore, there's no great incentive on the operator of this utility to reduce consumption. We might want to reduce energy consumption, but there's no great incentive to do so. You actually want to increase energy consumption to ensure that your income stream is maintained. And it's arguable that this kind of technology has therefore tended to promote waste, a resource consumption, promote water consumption, electricity use, and so on. And it's also arguable that this kind of infrastructure, this massive infrastructure, has tended to promote the trend towards large cities, because large cities have the resources to make these investments, whereas small cities don't. So in general, the infrastructure, the water supply, the electricity supply, and so on, will be better in large cities than in small cities. So if you want a comfortable life, you want to go to a nice place, go to a big city rather than a small city. Now, all of that, of course, is changing. With the logic, this ineluctable logic of the internet, this changes, because now, partly with decentralized technologies like photovoltaics and so on, but more importantly with smart grids and internet type-based systems, it now becomes possible and even economically advantageous to have much smaller localized systems. I know there's an autonomous building being constructed or designed here at NTU. Buildings which generate their own electricity, collect their own water, purify their own water, process their own waste, and related industries close by each other, which can work closely together in a symbiotic fashion. My waste heat is the energy input for your operation, for example. And that changes because of this logic of the internet. And so we come to the possibilities of the infrastructure in the Internet of Things era. It can unlock reserve capacity. As I've said, so much of this infrastructure is over-designed for simple economic reasons. But now we can use all kinds of sensor technologies to find out whether the technology, whether the infrastructure really can be extended or it can be used more intensively or something. So there's a real possibility using the Internet of Things. We can move at least from a mix of centralized and decentralized systems, and that's very clearly happening. Maybe we can move to completely decentralized systems, which becomes a very interesting opportunity for somehow keeping rural, dense rural populations in rural regions rather than forcing, encouraging them to migrate to big cities. We can make better use of resources through of the kind I've mentioned, through district energy, industry 4.0, district energy systems, smart transport, and so on. Many of these have much lower capital costs and much greater flexibility, so that you're not locked in to producing for 50 or 60 years in order to cover your costs. And that, of course, poses a major threat to business models of the larger utilities. And it's interesting that many large utilities, I mean, Australia, for example, have been distinctly hostile to the idea of creating smart grids and taking in electricity produced by windmills and photovoltaics because it threatens their economic model. And just a question, but maybe it also helps in a reduced trend towards large-scale urbanization, which, as Jan mentioned at the beginning, I believe that the megacity is simply, for many reasons, not the direction in which we wish to go. There are so many disadvantages as human populations, aggregates of human populations, move to 10 or 20 or 30 million people. So maybe these opportunities reduce it. Now, all of that sounds very positive. It's very good. These are wonderful aspects of the logic of the internet. There are, of course, also very problematic impacts, and we're familiar with them. There's cybercrime, which is, again, one of my experiences in being Singapore of the last two or three years, is the growing, I won't say hysteria, but the growing alarm of the possibilities of cybercrime. Financial fraud, IP theft, extortion, sabotage, drug trafficking, espionage, and so on. And there are lots of figures out there, but one of them is that it's costing globally $455 billion per year. Terrorism, again, of course, is a major cause for concern. The internet enables dispersed terrorist groups to operate. They have chat rooms, they have message boards, and they use these to share information, to coordinate their attacks, to raise funds, to recruit. Maybe even more concerning, but perhaps receiving much less attention, I think, is the possibility that the internet represents a severe threat to social cohesion. Because more and more people simply choose the information environment that they want to live in. They select the media they use, and of course they select media which support their own worldview. And so they expose themselves to opinions, to information, which reinforce their own opinions. And this seems to me a deeply worrying and problematic development. It is clear that in many democracies, attitudes towards opposing parties have shifted from being mildly negative to being outright hostile. And see if you can think of any cases which come to mind. And these are deeply problematic issues which are a consequence of this distributed information and universal access. So sometimes decentralization may have a strong downside to it. And of course, there's another very serious potential risk, and that is that we have now become inextricably dependent upon this internet. You could argue that we have become over-dependent, and there is probably a risk of catastrophic failure with all kinds of systems breaking down when the internet happens, but probably we will have to wait until it breaks down to find out just what those consequences might be. But it is a topic for very active research. So, okay, in summary then, I've talked about what I call system changes, three system changes, and I think you'll agree all of them have been highly disruptive. They have had consequences which have been profound, and they are still unfolding. Second thing is that most of those consequences were not foreseen. Different question whether they could have been foreseen, but mostly they were not foreseen. For example, in the case of the Green Revolution, I can remember that I can remember as a schoolboy, it was the end to hunger. That was all of it. That was all going to happen. Green Revolution, end to hunger. No mention of megacities or increasing discrepancies between the very rich and the very poor or whatever. All of these have been revolutions. They've all had winners and losers. And the benefits and the disadvantages are passionately contested. Again, the Green Revolution from a very early stage. There are people who argue passionately that that has been a disaster in many parts of India, that it's led to water shortages, it's led to the marginalization of remote rural areas, it's led to violent conflict, and there are those who say that this Green Revolution should never have happened. In each case, and maybe this is the most important part, in each case, very soon, the new technology has simply become the new reality. And that means that it's easy to lose sight of causality. These technologies, once introduced, simply become the norm. And so society goes through a kind of phase change, and the actual cause, the thing which drove it, we lose sight of. The other point I'd make is that in each of these, they were driven very much by government policy, I think it's true to say. And it's very clear that each of these revolutions has served an economic growth agenda. And there we come back to the point I mentioned right at the beginning, that there is this extraordinary obsession at the moment with innovation. Many governments around the world really pushing their innovation communities as hard as they can. And of course, the motivation primarily is one of the economic growth. So, I argue then that we've been a little bit myopic when it comes to introducing technologies. We introduce a technology but don't think too hard about what the consequences might be. And so why? What are the consequences? Why are we myopic? Why do we think so little? One is simply that the people who develop these things, the innovators and the developers, usually are experts and they have a rather narrow focus on the cause and effect. They argue we produce more food, there will be less hunger. End of story. Another is that innovators are extraordinary optimists. It's not a good idea to ask the innovator what the wider consequences of what they're doing might be, because those consequences will only be good. I can remember talking to one person who was trying to develop a sort of genetically modified bacterium to control insect pests, and their vision was to get up in an aeroplane and spray this over vast areas of countryside as a way of dealing with insect pests in fields. Couldn't understand why some of us were just a little tiny bit worried about the idea of billions of bacteria being sprayed around the English countryside. Another one, of course, is a matter of legal rights, and that is there is a presumed right to enjoy the benefits of one's own invention. So if somebody invents something, it's not right, unless there are very good arguments against it, to take it away. And also, there are very powerful commercial interests which actually don't want you to probe too deeply into what the consequences might be. And a very good example of this is GMO technology, where the companies which are developing GM technology have always argued very strongly to keep the safety studies to an absolute minimum, and as far as possible, sort of petri dish type studies on a limited number of organisms. But let's not go out and actually try it out in a real ecosystem. So there are powerful commercial vested interests which will tend to reduce the exploration of consequences. Then there are another set of interests and reasons. One is that we don't know how to assess the wider impacts. That's certainly the case, that very often we don't have the methods or we don't have the institutions that can take this broad interdisciplinary look at a problem. We simply don't have the methods. Another one, of course, is that these are extremely complex systems, and that makes forecasting difficult. And then another one, and I must say I thank Stuart Kaufman for this word, which I have never used in my life before, but I'm now going to use it for the first time. The non-ergodic nature of the consequences makes forecasting not difficult, but simply impossible. And I think all of those are valid reasons. They're all of them true. I don't think forecasting is completely impossible. I think the types of behavior that come out of particular types of innovations are possible. Take the three that we've looked at. One of them affected productivity. It was a dramatic change in food productivity. Another one affected the ability to control reproduction. A third one affected one's access and ability to use information. Now, you can say that all three of those are innovations which are affecting, in a very core sense, system properties. These are real system changes. And we may not know in fine detail how it will play out, but we know very well that if we can increase food productivity by a factor of five, it will have a major consequence, and probably doesn't require too much foresight to realize that the people who lose their jobs won't remain in the countryside. So in other words, I don't believe that forecasting is impossible, though clearly there are limits to it. So what can you do about it? There was an interesting study, or rather two studies, done by the European Environment Agency a few years ago, where they very strongly advocated the precautionary principle. They took a look at important developments over the last few decades which were clearly harmful and which it would have been good to stop at a much earlier stage. One was the collapse of fisheries in European waters. Another one was the mad cow disease, which was associated with cattle eating cattle feeds, including recycled dead cows. One was asbestos, lead and petrol, systemic insecticides, and so on. They took a look at all of these, and they said, why didn't we spot them? And when was the first warnings coming out? And from that, they produced two reports, one in 2001, one in 2013, called Late Lessons from Early Warnings. And these were the 12 late lessons. One is that, first of all, we simply need to acknowledge that we don't understand the system, acknowledge and respond to ignorance and uncertainty. We need to monitor. Once we release a new technology into the environment, we need to provide suitable monitoring. We obviously need to work to reduce the gaps in our knowledge. We need to reduce the interdisciplinary obstacles that we heard about earlier this morning. We need to ensure that the regulations reflect real-world conditions. In other words, doing a test on a standard insect larva in a petri dish is not the same as testing the thing in a field. We need to scrutinize both the claimed benefits and the risks. Now, this is perhaps a bit more controversial, but there should be no implicit right to introduce your technology if the benefits are marginal and the risks are unknown. We need to evaluate, in other words, the alternatives. We don't need to rely solely upon scientific knowledge, but the lay and the local knowledge. We need to look behind the assumptions and values of different social groups. We need to ensure that the regulators are independent, and we need to reduce institutional obstacles to learning and action, and finally avoid paralysis by analysis. Sometimes one needs to act even before all of the information is in. So that was very interesting, but that was dealing with a particular kind of innovation. Most of these innovations involve investigating or trying to interpret what happened when you released a large amount of a very biologically toxic material into the environment. And I found myself as I prepared this talk, I got on very well until this slide, and then I thought, I haven't been talking about that. I think none of us would dispute that we need to be much more careful, much more precautionary about releasing extremely toxic materials into the environment. But those aren't the three examples I spoke about. I talked about the Green Revolution. Surely that must be a good thing. The ability to control one's reproductive future. The internet with all of the possibilities. And it's hard to believe that any... In fact, I thought to myself, I sound a bit like a chap back in the Stone Age who was arguing passionately about not letting this stuff called bronze being used because we haven't done a full socio-economic analysis of it. So what am I trying to say? What's the point? What's the point? The point is clearly not that we have to look at in detail at the systemic consequences of every innovation, but we at least have to be interested and think about what those consequences might be. Not so that we can stop the project, but so that we can make sure that we respond where necessary. The Green Revolution, clearly, in a world where millions of people were starving, the Green Revolution was a very good thing. But wouldn't it have been nice to know in advance that it might lead to the process of the formation of megacities? Wouldn't it have been nice to know simply... Jakarta grew from 3 million in 1970 to, I think, over 30 million now, in a completely chaotic, higgledy-piggledy sort of way. Wouldn't it have been nice to have known back in 1970 that one of the consequences of this new technology would be a demographic upheaval of that kind? And that's, I think, essentially my main point in this talk, that we do need to think about the consequences of new technologies as we introduce them, not simply because they are potentially toxic or they may have undesirable ecosystem effects. So my final slide then is, we need to watch out for these system changes. They're not new. System changes are not new. I can mention bronze or iron or gunpowder or plows or steam engines or electric lights or internal combustion engines and many, many others, which have all also been system changes, which have changed our societies dramatically. What is new is that the adoption rates are now so much faster. The Green Revolution rolls out in a couple of decades. The oral contraceptives rolled out in a decade or so. The intranet is rolling out in the same rate. And so the consequences, and of course they're happening in a globalized world at a massive scale, and so the consequences, when they are negative, are that much more serious, and they can really take us by surprise. And so my final statement then is that in a crowded, interconnected world, it is important to anticipate disruptive changes. Some of them are at least in principle predictable, and I think it's important that we do our best to predict them. Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. Could you give an example of how could we predict consequences of system changers? Maybe with one of the models that you showed at the beginning, examples of companies like Uber or Airbnb. If we were to position ourselves, yes, back in the day, yes, how could we predict?
Many innovations, I think, simply do replace one way of doing something with a different way of things, which is perhaps a bit more efficient. So we have a wonderful new kind of washing up detergent where you need half as much as you did before. And I think that's unlikely to be a system changer. I think, systems depend upon flows of energy, they depend upon flows of information, they depend upon the ability to reproduce. There are some processes which are fundamental to any sort of human economic system. And it seems to me that an innovation which has the very significant potential to change the flow of energy or the production of food or reproduction, exactly the kinds of things I've been looking at. It seems to me that those kinds of things are really likely or potentially could change the system. So many, many innovations are simply, replacing A with B, which does it slightly better. But some of them we need to identify, because they really are going to the heart of how the system works.
Thank you. That was a beautifully clear lecture. Thanks very much indeed. A couple of comments. It's quite often we have the information, or a lot of the information, in advance as to what might happen when a new technology comes along. I remember reading in a paper called The Green Revolution, Generations of Problems, by Walter P. Falcon, who's an economist at Stanford. That was written in 1971, and I read it in 1971. All the problems that you talked about, plus a few others, Falcon had foreseen. He wasn't a graduate student or anything. He was head of a department at Stanford. He spoke Indonesian. He advised the Indonesian government and so on. Yet, everything you say happened. Similarly, reproductive rates have been declining well before the pill started in Belgium and France around 1800, before the Industrial Revolution hit France. And so we had loads and loads in Europe of evidence as to what would happen when there is quite a decline. And the declines in fertility rates were every bit as large as what happened with the pill. So you're not, I'm not saying you're inaccurate here, but I am saying we had lots of evidence in Europe as to what would happen, swift urbanization in Europe, etc., etc. And I think that, so I'm all for what you're saying, but I'm skeptical, or pessimistic, I should say, about our ability, even when we have the information, to take good notice of it. Let me give you one more example, and this is the example that worries me. I work in Silicon Valley, and the big thing there, obviously, is autonomous intelligence, artificial intelligence, whatever you want to call it, machine learning. I think that along the lines you're suggesting, which is, I would summarize as solutions bringing problems, I think this is the gravest set of solution or problems that we face besides climate change. Yet I work in this area, etc. We're doing next to nothing to look at that. We're relying on Stephen Hawking or Bill Joy or one of people like that to make some comments. So, 2 points. There's loads of information usually available before these technologies come about. And second point is that for some reason, even if we see these larger threats looming, we keep on working. And there isn't much in the way of convening people and asking about the consequences. I'd love to get your comments, because everything you're saying is valid here, but the human beings don't seem to be interested in looking far down the road.
Yes, yes. Well, thank you very much. I mean, those are very interesting points. First of all, yes, I mean, you're right. There's lots and lots of information, and as I tried to indicate, actually determining the cause in some cases is supremely difficult. I mean, the matter of birth rates is one. The matter of urbanization, I mean, some people dismiss the Green Revolution as having been a cause of urbanization because populations in cities were growing beforehand. So these are extremely complicated things. How do you tackle it? I mean, I think one thing is clearly the sort of complexity community. People who really think about systems rather than simply the immediate consequences. The problem of the Green Revolution, I think, as much as anything, was it was managed and thought through entirely within a group of people who were interested in plant breeding, or they were interested in agriculture and agricultural development. And I don't suppose anyone outside that community really thought about it. You know, a new variety had been introduced. the agricultural extension services were told, the seeds were being manufactured, and it was happening. And, you know, the person responsible for urban affairs in the government certainly hadn't been told about this. So I think that's one problem. It's partly a matter of our research and how we do it, how universities tackle these problems. There's huge governmental problems about the portfolios of different departments and sort of being interested and understanding. Recently, I gave a talk, and I started off by showing a slide which I like very much, and I think it was about 1910, and it was of Britain. It was the Royal Institution, and there was somebody giving a talk about I don't know the chemistry of hydrogen, I think, and sitting in the front row was the Prime Minister and the Chancellor of the Exchequer and various other people. And it was clear that, you know, 100 years ago in Britain, people were familiar with the developments in science and they were participating in a conversation. Now, all of that is long, long by. And we've created a government which has governments which have an extremely fragmented structure and very little ability to think through the wider consequences of new technologies. And I think three things have to happen. Universities have to adapt to embrace these questions. Governments have to reorganize. And universities and governments need to find a forum, rather like the Royal Institution, at which these conversations can continue to happen.
Peter, thank you. A wonderful paper. I want to refer to one of your first slides where you show the changing eco city. And on the top you say it's technological myopia.
Yes.
Still not too clear to me what is the myopia you're referring to. So if you would appreciate you say a few words on that slide, please. Thank you. Yep, that's the one.
No, this was technological utopia. This is not myopia.
Sorry, utopia.
This is utopia.
So what's the utopia? Can you just say a few words?
I think this is... I would describe this... This is simply a slide which captures the passionate belief of many people that we can use our technologies to create a much better world, a world in which people are safe, comfortable, which are sustainable, where the elderly are cared for, and so on. And so don't read too deeply into the fact that it's the Tianjin eco-city. It's merely a picture which captures this utopian view that with good technologies, we can enormously increase the well-being of people. Now, my criticism of that is that this is just one city. It's a sort of square kilometer in the middle of China. And in fact, the whole process of what is happening in China is one system. There are people, wealthy people, able to move there, and you can create a sort of relatively secluded environment where modern technologies create superb living conditions, but you have simply separated that off from a much more complicated, messy system, which is the reality. So I think when we talk about these technological utopia, we are very often looking at simply a fragment of the problem rather than the whole complicated, messy problem, such as the Green Revolution, which played out across the whole demography of countries.
Peter, how you measure utopia when all of us know that Tianjin Eco City is very much underutilized? It is classified as one of the ghost city. 10,000 populace, and we are talking of it as a utopia. So how do you measure utopia?
It's very funny you say that. I actually wanted to use a picture of Masdar as my example, and then I thought, oh dear, Masdar has been a complete failure. I'm not going to show a picture of Masdar. All I want to say is that there is a vision. There is a vision. There are many people in technology who believe passionately that we can create a... By using technologies, we can create a world which is very much better, which covers, which eliminates all of the problems that we currently have. And this picture is nothing more than a symbol of that. I'm just
Thank you.
You know so much about Tianjin Eco City.
Thanks very much, Peter. Very interesting, stimulating discussion. I want to just explore an idea, and this may be in some way trivial or unworkable, but it strikes me, again, as with Arthur, I've spent a lot of time in Silicon Valley and have seen, you know, sort of the height of sort of the market-driven innovation. And the question that I think about is, can we institute and I think maybe you're getting at this in a way, and I'm just trying to articulate a little more, to make the distinction between a socially driven and market-driven innovation, and that with that, the need to assess social needs as well as market potential, and to process this by engaging with a multi-sectoral community who might either influence or be affected by this development, whatever it is, and to be able to do that with the tools of complexity science, of sustainability and complexity. And I know that, I mean, this is a difficult process, but it seems that, because it involves all the issues of vested interest, IP, et cetera, but it seems to me that that may be one of the few ways, if that were, in a sense, if there was a benefit, in effect, in the communities that might be affected that want to have that seen. And the more we know about the negative consequences, the more that may be apparent.
This is a really deep and complicated question. I mean, we live in market economies in which, first of all, you know, it's a kind of presumed right of somebody with their intellectual property to be able to have it sort of tested out in the marketplace, and that we tend to reduce regulations that interfere with that right. And we need very good arguments. You know, we need arguments like we can demonstrate that that will have adverse ecological effects or something like that. But in general, there is somehow a presumption. And we don't have the institutions either, as we just said, you know, for understanding what those consequences might be. On the other hand, it really does seem to me that as we now, in a very critical phase, are moving, can we move to some sort of sustainability or not? You know, I mean, you showed beautifully the problems are just mounting at an extraordinary rate. Is it any longer acceptable that this sort of laissez-faire attitude to releasing your new technologies upon an unsuspecting public are acceptable? And if they're not, what kind of governance system or what kind of regulatory system is going to work? One thing I think we do know is that if we set up a centrally regulatory system, it will be a failure. They will not understand the problems, they will cause enormous irritation and so on. And normally when one tries to sort of step back from a free market economy to one in which there is regulation, it has exactly that effect. And then 10 years later, a new president comes into being and wipes them all away again. I mean, you know, that is the sort of cycle. So we do need to move towards some sort of a governance system that is capable of saying, what are the broader societal consequences of this, and what do we want to do? To be quite honest, I mean, it does mean, I'm sure, moving away from a free market growth economy. I mean, I can't see any alternative, but I don't have an answer.
But that's actually, I mean, a lot of what the issue with sustainable development versus sustainable futures, but it's also a matter then of really engaging with the population. It's not regulation, but a way, again, in this sort of transdisciplinary mode, that the population, the stakeholders, shareholders, et cetera, are in some real way engaged, I think.
Yes.
Anyway, but it is difficult.
Yeah. one of the things which, and in fact, it goes back to your talk as well, is this kind of sort of community ownership of important decisions. Now, I happen to be employed by a Swiss university and have lived in Switzerland for a very long time. And Switzerland is an extraordinary country in as much as it still has the communities and it still has this old, old tradition of communities making decisions about things. And it's extraordinary how it has built a tradition of responsibility about all kinds of things. And Eleanor Ostrom, for example, when she tried to understand how, you know, commons worked well, where did she go and study Swiss alpine communities? One of the things which really worries me in this sort of globalizing world with mega cities of kind of dispossessed people coming together is there's no kind of community which is going to take the responsibility and ownership for these very difficult decisions.
George. This interesting subject, which you so eloquently presented to us.
Can you put your hand up? I can't. Oh, there you are. Sorry. I'm looking all around the room.
Well, I was just complimenting you how eloquently you presented the subject, and you missed that. could be considered slightly differently, like co-evolution of technology and society. And when you read historians of technology, that co-evolution happens in very large steps at the time. It's not sort of linear at all. It's stepwise. And at every step, there are new technology causes very serious societal changes. But what is interesting that from recent research, it transpires that the strongest change and the most unpleasant happened after the agricultural technology enabled people to settle and to start working on the ground, because suddenly, instead of chasing antelopes together in gangs, 90% of people had to dig. From early hours to the real dark to dig the ground, and 10% managed them. So the inequality which was then created, we never managed to eliminate. That is the most probably tragic consequence. Yes. The Industrial Revolution caused enormous change in society, of course. I don't want to waste your time with that. But all this, I think, teaches us that this information revolution, switch from industrial society to information society, will be absorbed very much like all the others. This optimism comes from understanding the mechanism of self-organization.
Yes.
That society self-organizes to trying to eliminate disruptions all the time.
Yes.
And the less centralized society is, the better it is in self-organization. And currently, we have societies which are far less structured and rigid than during industrial transition from agricultural to industrial phase. So there is a considerable confidence that by helping even more to structure society in a distributed rather than rigid hierarchical manner, we shall enable that this transition to be absorbed without possible tragic catastrophic consequences.
In principle, I agree with you. I mean, just two comments. I think what has changed, you're quite right about this co-evolution, and that is true in the histories of technologies. But the rate at which these played out was so much more slow. I mean, I've talked about three major revolutions which have happened during my lifetime, and I could have mentioned others as well. So simply the rate is one thing. And then the second point is, I think this self-adjusting is probably correct. And if I was in a spaceship from Mars, circulating the Earth and merely observing this process of self-adjustment, I'd say to myself, never mind, it will adjust. But as a member of this society and going through the very uncomfortable process of self-adjustment, I have a different perspective. You know, the adjustments were often uncomfortable, bloody, ruthless, and it's quite true that, as a system, the system came out But, you know, sometimes I'm less interested in the system and more interested in myself.
Come. Thank you. Thank you for your beautiful lecture.
Can you
I'm here.
Oh, there we are.
I'm here. But you were, you're giving a lecture, which was my job. I was a head of a department, an institute for technology assessment in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
And now I want to confront you with something which, let me say it this way. We were cooperating in doing this. It was a group of about 30, 40 researchers and a group of 60 people, part of the Royal Academy of Sciences, working for Parliament. And it was on these issues. And similar organizations you have in Switzerland, in England, in Germany, connected to Parliament and in the Bundestag, whatever you have. Mm. And there is a lot of discussion going on these utopian things, on these new dystopian-like developments in the media. A lot. And there is and my experience is that members of Parliament like it. These confrontations, like the friction and the tensions. They like to take a stance. They like to anticipate on these developments. Mm. It was for my institute not a problem at all to get them involved in when it comes to early warning signals.
Yeah.
And I must say the government, at least in the Netherlands, and also in European Parliament, they were very anticipating on these developments. And now you are saying, no, this is not true. Mm. It's very bad in our countries. Yeah. Governments are doing nothing. Science is not active. It's not. I'll give you an example. Yeah. Please, and then give you, how is it possible that we have such a different views on this, on the way science and technology is coming in society? And even I want to go to the English doctors, medical doctors. There is a new technology coming on in genetics. Mm. It's called CRISPR-Cas, genome editing, which is very precise and very radical. And you can delete diseases in human beings, and you can delete diseases in animals, or whatever you have. Mm. It is coming, and it's much more effective than the classical genetic modification, what we this is coming up.
Yes.
The doctors, the medical doctors in the UK said, this is disruptive. Mm. This is going to change our medical practices and society. Let's go to the government. Yeah. So the medical doctors and the university professors in medicine, they organized the first meetings. And then they went together with the philosophers and ethicists to Washington for the first conferences. Mm. What the hell will this mean for society and for our professions? Mm. What are we doing with patients? They brought up on the agenda. Everyone is talking about it. And this is happening in 1 year.
Mm.
Yeah. In 1 year, it sets all over the world the agenda. And now you still are saying, this is going to be a dystopia. This is going wrong. The government is not involved. This is... So what is really going on? That's my question.
Where is the truth? Yes, right. Well, I mean, that's very interesting. And I actually don't disagree. I mean, the first thing is I would say we are getting better at it. I mean, I think, you know, it is interesting that more and more professional societies, academic societies, are doing horizon scannings. You know, this kind of horizon scanning activity, this sort of think tank activity where you try and see what is happening, is emerging. And some countries are doing it, not all, and others are certainly not. But a second point is that it's sometimes very difficult to distinguish between these and a whole sort of industry of soothsayers and futurologists and think tanks and so on, which have no particular academic status, which come up with all kinds of nonsense, and it's really very difficult, you know, I think, for a politician to know whether this is a serious analysis of what's likely to happen or simply some frustrated science fiction writer, you know, who's trying to sort of... And so... I mean, that is part of the reality. Then the third thing is, of course, you know, my innovations, you know, I went back to 1960, and it may be that if there were a green revolution in 2017, there would be a lot more serious consideration of it. But it didn't happen. I don't think it happened with the oral contraceptive pill. There is quite a lot of discussion about what will happen in the internet-networked community. But it's still not mainstream in the way we train undergraduates, not only to understand their own discipline, but also to understand the larger context. So, you know, I don't disagree with you. I think things are happening, but I think a lot more can happen.
Thanks for a very good lecture. I could be very selfish and ask you for help. Being a plant ecologist, can you look into your crystal ball and help us to identify how much, using the concept of biomimicry, that we can, from a plant ecologist, to look for system changer that we can use in our complex system, what you just talked about? Thank you. Mm.
Oh, dear, that's a really difficult question. I'm fully unprepared for that. I tell you the thing which always strikes me. You know, in fact, I give a little talk about Singapore. 200 years ago, Singapore was a rainforest. And it had a relatively equable rainforest environment. It certainly didn't have an urban heat island effect. It didn't have the extremely heavy storms it has and so on, you know. And it had been like that for 60 million years, so it hadn't worked badly. And one of the things about natural ecosystems is that they are highly decentralized. You know, so sort of the big centralizing systems, which are a feature of all cities, tend not to be there. And they also have a lot of functional redundancy in them. You know, you have many systems which essentially do the same job. And if there's a terrible disease and it comes and kills your dominant tree, not really a disaster because, you know, another tree will grow up from the undergrowth and so on. And I think, I'm not prepared for this question, but those are just two thoughts which I think in designing systems, this emphasis upon decentralization and an emphasis upon functional redundancy, I think are two really ecological lessons.
So there are potentially some general principle we can draw from you as a plant ecologist.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, one of the roots of complexity theory was ecology. I mean, it was people who looked at how ecosystems assembled and how they changed and how they developed resilience and so on. And, you know, that is one of the roots of complexity science, definitely.
Thank you for the very interesting lecture. My name is Benjamin from Biological Science. Just one question, carry on from the previous speaker. Regarding genetic engineering and in this time, designer babies. So what do you think this emerging genetic engineering technology such as CRISPR-Cas9, do you think it is a disruptive innovation and how do you think it will, do you think our society will progress to that stage? Thank you.
Oh dear. Some of these questions really tax a plant ecologist, I can say. The designer babies. I personally think this is one direction where we should go with the greatest possible caution. You know, I mean, I think it's one of those areas where we simply don't understand the biology of it well enough that you make genetic interventions into any organism. I mean, just to take a much simpler example of putting in pesticide resistant to a crop or something like that is still an extremely hit and miss process. You know, you transfer the gene, it's supposedly there, but it's not expressed. You know, we simply don't know enough about the operation of biological systems. So I think that is one purely scientific reason that, you know, for the utmost caution there. And then, you know, I think one is simply up against ethical reasons, you know. I mean, I think which are related to personal values and which, you know, it's not a direction that I personally would want to go.
Thank you.
Okay, let's thank Peter once again.
Before you go, this is the sun button. Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Indeed.